welcome everyone to tonight's inaugural lecture by Professor Alistair Borthwick, who is our new Professor of Applied Hydrodynamics. That's for his benefit, not for yours. So I'm Leslie Ellolies. I'm Vice Principal and Head of the College of Science and Engineering. And one of the great pleasures of my job is to chair inaugural lectures, which always reaffirm to me the excellence of our senior colleagues. So don't let me down, Alistair. Inaugurals are about exciting, about enthusing, about educating the audience. No pressure, Alistair. And for the lecturer to show off his research, to show off the research that resulted in their appointment. And I know there will be no pressure on Alistair there. I'd like to welcome everyone here, to Alistair's family, his wife Jill and his son James, to his special guests from near and far, to his friends and his colleagues. Please excuse me if I don't name you all, but Alistair is a popular chap. His invite list is long, and we want to hear from the man himself. But just briefly, let me give you a brief synopsis of Alistair's career. Prior to coming to Edinburgh, he was head of civil and environmental engineering at University College Cork, and before that, professor of engineering science at the University of Oxford. He's amassed more than 30 years' experience. The years are treating you well, Alistair. In civil, coastal, and offshore engineering. His research interests include numerical and physical modelling of coastal processes, flood risk, water quality, wave loading on maritime structures, and marine renewable energy. Alistair's excellent research has been recognised by numerous awards, including Emeritus Professor at St Edmund Hall, Oxford, adjunct professorships at Peking University and NUI Galway. He's fellow of the Royal Academy of Engineering and a fellow of the Royal Society of Edinburgh. He was awarded a DSC by the University of Oxford in 2007, and your most recent, I think, an honorary degree from Budapest last year, and particular welcome to this gentleman in his fine robes and medal sitting here. You're very welcome here indeed from Budapest. Alistair the man enjoys, or so he tells me, walking. And I gather you're one of a handful of Plymouth Argyle supporters.
Yes.
So with that pedigree, how are we not in for an enjoyable evening? Alistair, please present your inaugural lecture, Water and Sediment, a Cascade across Scales. Alistair.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Leslie. When I'm told that I look all right, this reminds me of my father when he came round after a coma and he pointed across. His first words were to another patient across the ward, "That man is going to die over there." That's possibly how I feel as the years go by. Thank you very much, Leslie. That's very kind. So, good evening, everybody. The title of my lecture is Water and Sediment, a Cascade Across Scales. And given that it's St. Patrick's Day, it's only fitting that he should introduce the subject with this lovely photograph by Michel Lefebvre of sediment-laden free surface flow passing over a stepped bed downstream of a dam in China, probably on the Yellow River. This striking image shows just how complicated yet beautiful water and sediment flows are in nature. See if this works. Yep. First, something about your speaker. I was born in Meriden in 1957. To quote William Blake, "My mother groaned, my father wept. Into the dangerous world I leapt. Helpless, naked, piping loud, like a fiend hid in a cloud." I always like talking, as this slide shows. More importantly, I was always curious, the first sign of academicitis. I was told off by teachers at my primary school for dreamily watching trawlers come in and out of the Barbican, my mind on much more interesting things, such as Plymouth Argyle. I maintained a collection of slugs, my only friends, and they inhabited an old tin in my bedroom until my mother, against my express against my express instructions, took the lid off and emitted a terrible shriek. And she saw the mush of slugs. I learnt that telling one's mother to not to open any can is a very big mistake. I did not have any early inclination to become an engineer. However, there were some signs. As a 9-year-old, I siphoned water out of a pond in the back garden using a tube. I drank the pond water as I siphoned. I stood up with pondweed hanging from my jowls, and that was my first encounter with environmental impact. Later, when at secondary school, I became interested in combustion. My cousin and I filled empty cigar cases with sodium chlorate, sugar, and fertilizer, and then set them alight using a fuse. We spent a happy afternoon detonating the cases in the basement of my uncle's house, emerging, blinking into the daylight to see my irate uncle coming down the path with the fire brigade. The neighbours had informed on us. A few days later, I told my schoolmates that sodium chlorate, sugar and fertiliser are really good for a blast. The resulting explosion blew a hole in the staff room door, and the guilty was sent home, and the incident was eventually resolved by a beating. Actually, I should use this. The strap, which I did think of bringing today, but I was discouraged, was later sent to me by my old physics teacher when I became a don at Oxford. Publication is very important if you want to have impact. My first published work was on the future of the railways, written from a revolutionary Marxist perspective in 1971. God help the readers. A letter to the Guardian in 1972 about the unfair naming of a woman prostitute at a trial was accepted for publication until my parents found out. A later letter on police and immigrants was published in the local newspaper, having escaped the notice of the censors at home. These were all signs of a future academic career. While a student at Liverpool University, yes, that's the one, I was also employed by South West Water Authority. And this job included surveying a failing water treatment plant at Dartmoor Prison, a very handy place when I got locked out of my Land Rover. At Camel's Head Sewage Works, I was told of a sailor who had got drunk, vomited out his false teeth into the toilet and pulled the chain, as one does. And the teeth travelled along the sewers and were screened out at entry to Camel's Head Sewage Works. The next day, the sailor made his way to Camel's Head, found the teeth drying out on the side, and after checking that they fitted properly, went on his way. During the drought of 1976, I was put in charge of a water transfer project, smaller than the south to north one in China. A gate was left open to the field in which the pipes were being laid, and a bull wandered out, and it crossed onto a bridge, and it held up all the traffic between Cornwall and England. From 1978 to 82, I carried out research as a PhD student, working on flow past a cylinder, the topic relevant to offshore structures that were being constructed at the time. I was not, now I'll do Trump, not, repeat, not, responsible for the riots that disrupted part of the university area in 1981. After completing my doctorate, I spent 18 months working for Brown and Root, helping to design the Hutton tension leg platform. And at the time, the Hutton tension leg platform was a completely innovative floating platform that operated rather like an inverted pendulum, so it's like a balloon tethered to the seabed by mooring tethers. And the platform was floated out, installed, and it won the Queen's Award for Technological Achievement in 1984. It completed its design objectives as an oil production platform in the North Sea and was later purchased by Gazprom and now resides as a hulk in the Cromarty Firth near Inverness. I spent nearly seven years at Salford University working for a very supportive and eminent professor of engineering hydrology. There were excellent laboratory facilities and quite a large department, rather like my school. It's all gone, like our youth too soon. From 1990 to 2011, I worked in the Department of Engineering Science at Oxford. As Chaucer put it, yet had he but little gold in coffer, but all that he might of his friend's hent, on books and on learning he it spent. Perhaps. The University of Oxford is a wonderful place to work once you get to grips with its rhythm, its weird matrix-like college department structure, its traditions, and its inbuilt sense of confidence. For me, it was wonderful to experience true academic freedom. As a boy from a state school in Plymouth, to arrive at Oxford was the academic pinnacle. And this slide shows various members of the Ocean Engineering and Dynamics Group in 2006. And here we see the Engineering Centenary Committee in the basement of St. Paul's Cathedral inspecting a plaque to Robert Hooke, who, as you can see, was hung by Newton. From left to right, we have Richard Darton, head of department, and Rita Greer, the artist, Martin Rees, who was the president of the Royal Society, and Alan Chapman, who was a historian, and somebody else lurking in the shadows. My time at Oxford was very happy, and I made many lasting friendships. I was promoted to reader and then professor of engineering science. In my final years at Oxford, I was deputy head of department and dean at St. Edmund Hall, where my teaching room was located in the belfry of the Church of St. Peter's of the East. And here we see St. Edmund, a scholar born in 1185 and variously educated in the universities of Oxford and Paris. It's recorded that Christ appeared in person to Edmund as he walked across the fields on his way from Abingdon to Oxford. Moreover, during a sleepless night, his mother saw Edmund bearing on his head a crown of thorns, brightly blazing, whose flame rose to the sky. It was said that when he read in ye schools, he was assisted by an angel in ye shape of a beautiful young man. After his death, the University of Oxford wrote to Pope Innocent, asking that Edmund be canonized a saint, noting that his miracles had cured many different persons of their diseases. I think it's the first time that a university petitioned for someone to be a saint and succeeded. To quote Henry Beeching, and perhaps Leslie Yellowlees, "First come I, my name is Jowett. There's no knowledge, but I know it. I am master of this college. What I don't know isn't knowledge." That's the theme in Oxford. After more than 20 years at Oxford, Jill and I proposed a change. I then spent 2 years at University College Cork, where my grandmother, who's here, graduated in 1915. And here we see the civil engineering building and the three-sided quad. I can answer questions on that later. While I was at UCC, Mike Hartnett, Kahuro Brody, Jerry Murphy, Tony Lewis, Gillian Bruton, and others helped me found the SFI Centre for Marine and Renewable Energy Ireland. And this centre brought together academics from all across Ireland to work on marine renewable energy, and it was supported by Science Foundation Ireland and 50 companies. I'm proud to say that it's doing well. In October 2013, I moved from UCC to the University of Edinburgh, where my grandfather had graduated in medicine exactly 100 years before. I was appointed Professor of Applied Hydrodynamics, and we can see here the writings of Robert Louis Stevenson about hydrodynamics here, obviously enthralled with the subject. Now I need help from an angel. Yes, health and safety means that he must wear a white coat, because this is a very, potentially very dangerous exercise. And
I don't quite know what to do.
If you were to put the, if I can explain in the with a stochastic differential equation, preferably, if you could put that one in first over the spoon. That's it, but it should hopefully form a layer. There's no pressure, but we have an expert on stratified flows just over there. And others. That's good. That'll do. And now the other one. Yes, that will just about it will do enough. It will show them that I am not actually who I say I am in a minute. And I think that's fine, Tom. I wouldn't worry too much. It's apparently very difficult to make this, according to Jill. It's got two colours. Well, I was hoping for the three colours of the tricolour there. It might emerge, but anyway, it's certainly stratified. Okay. Thank you very much, Tom. It's almost like the Royal Institution here. In the film Holocaust 2000, Angel Kane, a British Antichrist, was complimented on a stratified cocktail by an unwitting victim. And the Brantichrist replied that it was merely the application of applied hydrodynamics. So what is applied hydrodynamics? As the Brantichrist would have said, it is simply the branch of physics which treats of the forces acting upon or exerted by fluids, by liquids, and puts them into practice. Well, this lecture fits this definition by considering the effect of water-sediment force interactions. In particular, we will examine the influence of scales on water-sediment flows. And I've divided the talk into three sections, three themes really: the scales themselves, the form taken by geomorphological systems when acted upon by the water and sediment, and then some lessons that result from looking at two or three examples of human interference with the water-sediment system. So scale. Well, scale refers to size both in length and time and perhaps other things. We can define scale as being the relative or proportionate size or extent in this thing. So we should be aware that there are physical limits to our scales, whether they be space, time, mass, energy. And I'll try and explain those limits in terms of space following some ideas that were first expressed, I think, by Professor Xijun Liao of Shanghai Jiao Tong University. And first we'll look towards the infinitesimal. So at the smallest scale, we have the Planck length scale at around 10 to the minus 35 meters. And that's the scale below which it's impossible to determine the difference between two locations, and so defines inherent microscopic physical uncertainty. In other words, how short can be a piece of string theory, if I'm right. Sorry about that. A whole lot larger is the Bohr radius, the radius of a hydrogen atom, which is about 10 to the minus 11 meters, swept out by the electron moving around the path of the spinning electron. Larger still is the diameter of the Earth at 12.7 thousand kilometers. And then an astronomically large scale for engineering purposes would be the diameter of the Milky Way at 105 light years, or almost 10 to the 21 metres, which is a pretty big number for us. Well, Liao Shijun, who's pictured here opposite President Xi Jinping, he made an engineering approximation to the ratio of the smallest, which is the Planck number, to the large diameter of the Milky Way, and found it was 10 to the minus 56. So Liao argued that you'd need at least 60 significant figures effectively to track what happens to micro-level uncertainty through to the macroscopic level that might exhibit itself as fluid turbulence or the locations of stars. And to calculate this, he developed a method for solving the nonlinear equations that he encountered called clean numerical simulation, where he used numbers which had 4,180 digits to do it, and he was able to produce some absolutely amazing calculations, extraordinary feats of accuracy. And this idea could enable the fluids community to develop a new way of modelling flows at multiple scales. For example, consider my height given to 4,180 significant figures. The first 35, which are up there in black, are meaningful somehow. The rest in red are definitely not, being smaller than the Planck length scale. And the lesson here is that we must use common sense when evaluating multi-scale problems. We now take up the theme of scales as applied to water and sediment, water first. At the smallest scale are the water molecules, around 10 to the minus 10 meters. And then at a largest scale, perhaps, are the oceans, whose maximum depth is about 11 kilometers, and they occupy about two-thirds of the planet, or the surface of the planet. So the ratio between the minimum and maximum scales turns out to be about 10 to the minus 14. The picture in the background is of Noah's flood, taken from a book on climate change written by Dr. Thomas Burnett in 1687 that one can find in Teddy Hall Library. In the author's words, we may entertain ourselves with the consideration of the face of the deluge and of the broken and drowned earth in this scheme with the floating ark and the guardian angels. Well, water and sediment mixtures and environmental flows do involve a huge range of scales, both in space and time. Clay particles have diameters in the order of microns, whereas boulders, it's meters. Bed morphological features can be hundreds of kilometers in extent, and geomorphology can be viewed as having spatial scales extending to the diameter of the planet. Here we see rather large sediment particles that are transported along the Sand River in Ontario, Canada. It's worth comparing the size of the particles to the bridge in the distance. And not all particles transported by water originate from stone. Here we see an elephant that was washed up into a tree by a flood flow in Sri Lanka in 2011. Sediment deposits can be very similar. And imbrication, which is here, occurs when we have cobbles which are laid down in a very regular fashion. And the cars here, after the Japan tsunami, also been laid down in a rather similar way. Well, returning to the numbers, the ratio between the sediment, the smallest, sorry, and largest scales for sediment seems to be in the order of about 10 to the minus 11. And the motions of the smallest particles are strongly linked to erosional processes, such as those seen in this beautiful photograph of the erosion of the Jurassic coast in south, along the south of England. Fluids in motion also transfer energy across a range of scales. At the largest scale, we've got the eddies, very large eddies, which can be the size of the container. And then there is a cascade of self-similar smaller and smaller eddies, and finally dissipation into heat. And this effect, it leads to turbulence, such as in this shot here from Fukushima and Westerville, of a turbulent jet. In the words of Lewis Fry Richardson in the 1920s, big whirls have little whirls that feed upon their velocity, and little whirls have lesser whirls, and so on to viscosity. Large-scale eddies, which are often generated by the flow interacting with an obstacle, have a size that could be as large as the container. In other words, as big as the ocean or as small as the cup. The smallest eddies could be at millimeter scale, where the energy is converted to heat and dissipated. Between the two extremes, the flow tends to be self-similar with lots of different sized eddies and getting progressively smaller. And so here we see a visualization of the Gulf Stream making its way up towards the north of Scotland, hopefully. And it's been obtained from the fusion of 30 months of data from several satellites and numerical models. And we can see many gyres that are driven at the edges of the stream. I need to go on one. Sorry, this is me coping with technology here. Right, go to that one. Good luck, yeah, good. Well, NASA has produced this fascinating animation of these ocean surface processes. And the energy cascade is here evident through this transfer from the mainstream to the gyres and so on. And this involves so-called big data, where enormous quantities of information are generated and analysed through data mining and processing techniques. This enables evaluations to be made of the ocean transport of mass, heat, carbon and other chemicals by the circulating currents, and let us examine certain global problems, and one might be the accumulation of plastic debris in the oceans, a subject that's being considered here at Edinburgh by Ton van den Bremer. So to recap, we're almost at the end of the formula now. In physics, the largest objects are about 10 to the 56 larger than the smaller, or smallest. The corresponding ratios for water and sediment on Earth are about 10 to the 14 and 10 to the 11, respectively. Water and sediment science is thus truly multi-scale. We shall now examine what this means when water and sediment are released into the wild. William Blake's poem now comes to mind, to see a world in a grain of sand and a heaven in a wild flower, and hold infinity in the palm of your hand and eternity in an hour. I'll try to remain within the hour. We'll now turn to form. What are the shapes sculpted in nature by water and sediment as they pass overland into rivers, through deltas, into the sea, and along the coast? First, we need a short explanation of sediment transport, which can be classified into sheet flow, bed load, sediment load. The sheet flow is where we've got layers close to the bed that essentially just slide over each other. Bed load is when the particles start to roll. They can slide, but they tend to be hopping. This is saltation. When the turbulent flux is enough to lift the sediment up into the flow, finally, and overcome maybe the fall velocity of the sediment, then we get suspended sediment. Well, Lagrangian particle tracking provides insight into the behaviour of saltating or hopping particles near the bed. And this method involves following the motion of, say, a single particle as it hops along, hitting the bed particles, maybe making, I can just about show you here, there's an impact angle that a particle makes before it goes on. And that impact angle, we'll say, is alpha. So we simply let the particle go and then observe the trajectory. And the lower picture from Punch in 1847 shows the same kind of thing with railway locomotives. And this actually is saltation, the great engine match. And their scale, by the way, is not very dissimilar to the large boulders, or maybe even the elephant we saw earlier. So at certain flow speeds, the particles could actually keep landing on exactly the same place by a kind of miracle in a way, and we would get a periodic behaviour. But generally speaking, they kind of bounce around in different ways, and we get essentially a chaotic signature. That's the displacement, that's time. Here I'm plotting the impact angle against the flow velocity. And if I just go here, at some particular flow velocity here, they always land at the same spot. So this is periodic behavior. Then it bifurcates, it lands at two different spots, then more and more, and finally we just get chaos. The traditional way, leap over here again, for estimating the bed load is to use empirical formulae. And as we can see, a huge number of formulae have been proposed, which you're not seeing the formula, just the names, most of which are only applicable within a narrow range of the experiments conducted. There's no universal formula, and this empiricism feeds into the sediment transport models and hence into the estimates of the way in which rivers, deltas, beaches and coasts evolve. At Edinburgh, Sergio Maldonado, now at Stanford, and who prepared this slide, developed a quasi two-layer model to deal with this. So we have a bed load layer, which is sandwiched between the bed itself and suspended material here. He idealized the concentration distribution into essentially three lumps dealing with each layer. And then by including as much of the physics that he could, he derived a theory which allowed one to estimate the bed load as a function of shear stress, and we see the results here plotted against six other standard empirical formulae, and the agreement is very promising. Maggie Creed used a continuum-based approach, and she predicted the evolution of a hump in a channel. We can see this space-time plot here, so the hump is just moving towards the right, gradually steepening up. There's a semi-analytical solution by mathematicians in Reading, and her results give very good agreement. And this shows a further piece of work where she is predicting the we have initially a roughly 40 metre high dam break up here. This is 50 kilometre channel here. And after the dam break has occurred, this is some time later on, she is able to plot the water surface, the front, which is moving, I reckon, about 100 miles an hour, and gouging out the bed. And the results are very similar to those obtained before by Zhijian Cao, Gary Pender, Stephen Wallace, and Paul Carling, which we used as the reference case. Although suspended sediment particles are very fine, their impact at large scale can be impressive, as can be seen from this near-shore sediment plume in the Gulf of Mexico. And we can see very clearly the complicated, essentially, roll-up into vortices and so on along the edge of the plume. And this slide shows sediment transport. Perhaps I'll move on to this slide here. In a river in Taiwan, and you can see the coarse particles, which would be bed load, and then the murky flow, which is the signature of quite highly suspended sediment load. Well, sediment has a major environmental impact, and this is an example of pollutant transport by surface runoff from agricultural land which has been contaminated by fertilizer chemicals in the USA. At high concentration, sediment-laden flow no longer behaves as a Newtonian fluid. In other words, for those that know, the shear stress is not directly proportional to the rate of change of strain. And here we see a debris flow entering a river in Yunnan province in China. We'll leap across, whoops. Show a little film now. Sorry if it's a bit noisy. I'll shout. So here we see the arrival of a debris flow triggered by researchers from the Chinese Academy of Science, Sichuan University and Tsinghua University. The flunt does not move in the same way as water, and in fact it carries a huge amount of energy, as we'll see in a moment, when the front finally reaches the mountainside on the far side. It's more like a powdery flow, but there's a lot of energy, as you'll see by the splash in the moment. I hope it'll be a good one. You really wouldn't want to be standing up in such a flow. Right, I'll stop it now, and I'll move on. Yeah. Oops. Ah. That's it. The consequences of sediment-laden flow, though, can be tragic, as is evident in the aftermath of these dam break flows in China, and this landslide in Gansu in 2010, which killed more than 1,000 people. So it's a highly important problem. Well, water flows within a channel or basin, and during that time it can entrain, transport and deposit sediment, thus changing the shape of the channel or the basin. And rather like an artist, the water sediment flow sculpts forms, and we're going to commence with bed forms. So here we'll see some tide and wind induced sand ripples. They're relatively small scale bed features that commonly occur in nature, with the sand transported by small eddies behind each ripple. At larger scale are dunes, usually with ripples on top, such as these at Erg Chebbi in Morocco and Noakis Terra in Mars. And here we see a sand wave, which is even bigger, on the bed of a river, and offshore sand waves and a sandbank under the sea. So all these things are at different scales. Now we'll turn to full-scale rivers, and now we have real complexity and interdisciplinarity, where the engineer meets the geoscientist. The uppermost reaches of some rivers are fed by meltwater from mountain glaciers, and this image shows the relics of glacial outbursts flows in Bhutan. And in fact, a similar kind of outburst flow created what I call the English Channel, or maybe French Channel, long, long ago. As rivers flow downstream, the flow slows, the interaction with the morphology can form these kind of sinuous meandering shapes. And this is the Yellow River going through the lowest plateau in China. And now we have a series of aerial photographs showing braided flow channels of the Rakaia River crossing the Canterbury Plains in New Zealand. The beauty of the River Congo, the Ob River in Russia, and these staggeringly beautiful patterns of braided rivers in Iceland. In 1473, the great hydraulic engineer, Leonardo da Vinci, sketched the morphology of the Arno Basin. This was later followed by sketches of the topography of a river valley and a proposal for a flow diversion of the Arno River at about 1500. What's particularly interesting about this sketch is that it appears to show the self-similar or fractal nature of river branching. And this photograph from National Geographic magazine makes the point, these are not trees, these are alluvial channels. As a good scientist, Leonardo da Vinci went on to make a hypothesis that all the branches of a tree at every stage of its height, when put together, are equal in thickness to the trunk below them. All the branches of a watercourse at every stage of its course, if they're of equal rapidity, are equal to the body of the main stream. Leonardo also sketched a tree with a numbering system for the branching. About 400 years later, Horton and Strahler discovered that a branching numbering system, which in a sense is pretty well identical, certainly Horton, to Leonardo's here. And here we see the number of branches at different orders for the Leonardo tree plotted. Well, further complications arise when the river sediment water mixture erodes steep-sided mountains or canyons to form fans, or meets the sea, developing deltas and nearshore sediment plumes. And here we see the Badwater fan in Death Valley, California. And this fan has been caused by a surge flow after very intense rainfall that then carried the sediment and dumped it in a cone. And now a tiger seen admiring the beauty of the Sundarbans between India and Bangladesh. The Betsiboka Delta, Madagascar. Oh, whoops, passed by it. Right, there it is. This delta resembles, in my mind, a giant squid from above. And here we have the multiple channels converging and focusing on a single exit to the sea. And this NASA image depicts the almost biological structure of the Lena Delta, Siberia, and its intensely complicated tree of branching river tributaries and leaf-like lakes. Did an artist paint this photograph of the Gruink Glacier River in Alaska as it divides into multiple channels and flows into the sea? The end result of the multiple scales can be seen in these images of the Yellow River Delta and the Mississippi Delta. And the Yellow River Delta looks rather, I call it a bird's beak delta, and this one I call a bird's foot delta. And it's, the reasons are to do with slightly different compositions of the sand material. And here you see a very complicated pattern, but again a fractal one with multiple branching features. So now let's take out our buckets and spades and head off for the seaside. Well, sediment particles are swept along the coast by littoral drift, that's a current really along the beach, and rocky headlands tend to survive as the beach is then sculpted out, and in these cases more or less in a logarithmic form. And these beautiful diagrams again come from Leonardo da Vinci, of these arcuate beaches at the Pontine Marshes in Italy. Well, we can have bed forms at beaches, and these show multiple bars offshore of the Mississippi, or within the Mississippi Sound, and submerged crescentic bars at a beach in Algeria. And then, as the wave heads normally towards, straight on towards a sandy beach, a process of self-organization can occur whereby the sediment transport, wave breaking, shape of the beach reach an equilibrium, and the beach forms a pattern of repeating cusps, such as this one shown here. Oops, gone past one. Well, over the years, we've carried out research into this phenomenon. And here we see the Coastal Research Facility, which is a rectangular wave basin in which we put in a beach with three little cusps on it. That was all we could afford. And we carried out the tests in the mid-1990s, maybe kind of even before some people here are born, I think. And the left-hand plot shows the experimental data, and in it we can see there are these circulation cells where we've got kind of longshore currents coming together and then forming rip currents that go out at the deeper parts of the embayment. So you can see them going out just here. I'll show some other photographs which will show them rather better in a moment. And the right-hand image shows results produced by Ben Rogers in the early 2000s, predicting these using a wave period averaged numerical model. Gone past that one. Right, well, more recently, Francis Judge, who's here, has, at Edinburgh, has modelled these, showing here we've got the waves coming up at the tricuspate beach, and we can see the waves breaking at the beach, and then we can see also the development of the current pattern with all the actually period average current pattern here. This is, Frances will be submitting her thesis shortly. This is about 20 years after the original experiments were undertaken. So we move at a slow process. Well, multicusp beaches are to be found almost everywhere. And now you see them, you'll see them everywhere. And here we see a prime example of the coast of one of the Aleutian Islands off Alaska, and a multicusp pocket beach in Dorset. And the scale of the cusps is defined by the people who are walking along the shore. And if we zoom in a bit closer, we can see the swash interacting with the cusp. This is the low part of the cusp. And then off, further off, we can see essentially rip heads taking place. And we get a rather better picture here, where we can see the rip current coming out at the deeper part of the cusp and then dissipating out here. And you can see the rip current is actually very narrow when it takes place. At larger scale, the beach features can repeat themselves due to shoreline instability, and that would be requiring the right geological sediment, transport and wave conditions. And this shows this rhythmic pattern of cusps and spits is along the coast of the Amur Sea. Moving up the scales, we again find repeating patterns, this time of welded bars at Cape Cod, Massachusetts, and alternating cusps and embayments at Cape Hatteras. And finally, we should note that the coastal morphology can be ever-changing, such as is the case at Cape Cod, where the barrier beaches and spits are purely ephemeral. And here at Cape Hatteras, where submerged sandbanks drift slowly along, forming ribbon-like shapes, and these giant sand waves in the Wadden Sea. We next consider two kinds of human water sediment interaction from which lessons can be learned. One category is tailing ponds, the other hydropower dams. Well, tailing ponds are commonly used to prevent particles of mine waste from polluting the surrounding land. And the layer of water acts as a lid, keeping the nasty material in. They can be very large, such as this series of uranium waste ponds in Wyoming. It's obviously pretty important that the walls of the pond do not breach, but breaches do occur. And this photograph shows the hole in the wall left behind after a breach of uranium waste from a tailings reservoir in New Mexico in 1979. And then, sadly, on my father's 90th birthday, 4th of October 2010, the corner wall of a tailings pond failed, and this was at Veszprém in Hungary, and bauxite waste, about 1 million meters cubed of toxic water and mud, and of liquid waste, escaped, and the resulting mud wave of red toxic sludge caused 10 fatalities and injured 150 people. A true disaster. In 2014, a breach caused the Mount Polly copper and gold mine disaster in British Columbia. A slurry comprising millions of cubic meters of toxic water and mud entered Quesnel Lake, which was until then reputed to be the cleanest fjord lake in the world. And these NASA images show the situation before, there it is, and the situation afterwards where it's gone into the lake. In 2013, almost 12,000 tailings ponds existed in China. Here we see a pond near Baotou, the largest city in northern Inner Mongolia, with a population half that of Scotland. The pond takes rare earth and steel waste and extends for almost 6 kilometres. In an 8-year period from 2006 to 2014, China experienced 56 tailing-related pollution incidents, such as this one in July 2010, when copper mine waste entered the Ting River in Fujian. While researchers at Beijing Normal University have applied hazard zonation methods to evaluate the risks posed by tailings ponds near major conurbations. And this image shows the locations of a whole lot of tailings ponds in an area that's upstream of Beijing, and that's the main reservoir for Beijing. And then they were able to come up with essentially a risk hazard map, showing that the risk actually increased more and more as you headed towards the reservoir into Beijing. Now we turn to the movement of waste particles by wind-induced water circulation in a shallow mine tailings pond. Well, for simple unsteady flows, it's possible to obtain very complicated particle motions, a symptom of chaotic advection, which can be important in environmental mixing and dispersion processes. So we consider this mine here, the Heath steel lead zinc mine, and it's been divided into several cells to keep in the waste. And here we can see a grid that's been fitted to them, and then Chua Liang carried out computations where he altered the direction of the wind blowing across this, and then we added particles. Typical flow pattern shown on the left, and we can see these gyres within there. We run the wind from one direction than the other, so we have a different other pattern, and then a bit like the poem, it keeps just changing the wind direction from time to time. And then by looking at the positions of particles after each period, we can then see that some zones, the particles just go around in circular or closed orbits, which indicate the behavior is periodic, sometimes chains of islands, sometimes chaotic, sometimes just don't enter anywhere at all. And this is very useful if we're considering mixing and dispersion. We then allowed the seeding particles to undergo some kind of autocatalytic reaction. So in other words, we divide the flow field into a few A particles, which might be the baddies, and the remainder composed of B particles. And as the A particles meet the B particles, the A particles convert them into additional A particles, a bit like an infection. And here we see the results obtained by introducing some black particles which can react into otherwise white particles, and then you can see the build-up of these filamental structures with tendrils and whorls. And now if we look at blue-green algae in Lake Atitlan in Guatemala, we see the same type of structure. So maybe we can use some similar techniques to model eutrophication. Now we consider the lessons learnt from hydropower schemes that have been constructed along three large rivers in China. The Yangtze River, which is this one in the middle, the Yellow River at the top, or Huanghe, and the upper Mekong River, which then heads off down towards Thailand. The Yangtze River is the third longest river in the world, and its upstream gorges between Chongqing and Yichong are of immense beauty. The poet Yuan Zhen wrote that it is difficult to be water for the one who has seen the great seas, and it is difficult to be clouds for one who has seen the Yangtze gorges. On the other hand, the Yangtze River poses a major flood hazard. Here, Mao Zedong, the great helmsman, gives instructions to hydraulic engineers at Tsinghua University. Mao's 1956 poem, Swimming, contains the lines, "Walls of stone will stand upstream to the west to hold back Wushan's clouds and rain, till a smooth lake rises in the narrow gorges. The mountain goddess, if she is still there, will marvel at a world so changed." The poem points towards a dam at the three gorges of the Yangtze River. Between 1994 and 2003, the Three Gorges project was constructed following the poet's edict. The reservoir has a storage capacity of nearly 40 kilometers cubed, a power capacity of about 22.5 gigawatts, and has greatly reduced the flood risk to millions of people. However, there are adverse impacts, biodiversity degradation, 1 million displaced people, the ecosystem is harmed, flooding of archaeological sites, slower flow leading to sedimentation, increased scour, and blooms of toxic algae, an increase in seismic activity and landslides due to the sheer weight of water in the dam, behind the dam, and then the risk of dam failure affects nearly 70 million people. Well, having lost their easy access to their spawning grounds, the Chinese sturgeon, Dabri sturgeon, and Chinese paddlefish have almost disappeared. The Chinese river dolphin is gone. The vast area of the Three Gorges Reservoir has encouraged the spread of Onsomalania snails, which carry the parasitic disease schistosomiasis, as this heart-rending image taken from the 1950s or 60s, when it was last there, shows. We next turn to the Yellow River up here. Well, the Yellow River is the second longest river in China and carries about 6% of the world's sediment load. Although the cradle of Chinese civilization, the Yellow River is also called China's sorrow because of the scale of its flood disasters throughout history. One flood in 1931 caused somewhere between 1.5 and 4 million fatalities. In the Tang Dynasty, the poet Li Bai wrote, "Have you never seen the Yellow River waters descending from heaven, entering the ocean, never to return?" From the 1960s onwards, the flow in the lower Yellow River reduced, partly because of upstream irrigation practices, and so a program of soil and water conservation practices was implemented. Over 110,000 sediment check dams like this and 4 million water retaining structures were built. It's quite a scale. A cascade of hydraulic projects has also been constructed along the main course of the Yellow River. And the largest dams have impacted on the water sediment characteristics of the river. So this left plot here shows the cumulative sediment load against water discharge at a place called Tang Nai Hai, which is in the upper Yellow River Basin. There are no dams above this. And here we see that this cumulative diagram over quite a number of years, maybe from the 1950s onwards, is almost a straight line. That indicates no human or climate change effects. However, if we go to Huayuanko, which is close to the first photograph where St. Patrick entered us to this lecture, here we've got two dams nearby, San Mensha, which was constructed in the 1960s under the express wish of Chairman Mao, and then it was then altered a bit in the 1980s because it silted up, and then Xiaolangdi, which was became operational in the early 2000s. So this is actually a timeline here. You can see that the construction of this dam, the line changes slope slightly, but much more for Xiaolangdi. This shows the fact that it's regulating the river, but it's also having a big effect. Even so, the reservoirs are gradually silting up. The barriers created by the dams have led to reductions in the number of certain indigenous species of semi-migratory fish, and 13 species are almost extinct. And the Yellow River is perhaps no longer as yellow as it was more than 10 years ago when this photograph was taken. Last case. We now consider the hydropower dam cascade under construction along the Mekong River, particularly the upper Mekong River. And the Mekong River starts in China and passes, it passes through really parts of Myanmar, Laos, Thailand, Cambodia, and Vietnam, and then it discharges into the China Sea. And this is a case where transboundary problems result from upstream users altering the water sediment characteristics of a river. And China is constructing its cascade of 8 dams along the upper Mekong, one of which is this 4.2 gigawatt dam at Xiaowan. And the dams alter the downstream flow and the sediment discharge, and they've been causing increased fluctuations in the dry season and a decline in sediment flux. Rather like the Yellow River, it becomes less yellow. There have been warnings that the dams under construction by China and the planned dam by Laos will have dire consequences for the Tonle Sap, or the Great Lake in Cambodia, which is connected by a tributary to the Mekong River. The water level in the lake varies seasonally from 0.5 meter to 8 meter deep, and its unusual ecosystem supports fish stocks that supply 80% of Cambodia's protein. Again, the large fish are disappearing, such as these catfish that are under threat from the Xiaoburi Dam in Laos, So what should be done? Well, the various stakeholders must communicate better with each other, involve the public and prevent transboundary disputes. Sustainability assessment requires better eco-environmental monitoring and should be based on principles of fairness and equity. Impact assessments need to be holistic, and improved resettlement policies are required for displaced people. Li Qingzhao, a famous Song Dynasty poet, here, takes us back to a more environmentally sustainable time in her wistful poem called On the Lake. The waves sparkle as the wind blows on the lake. As autumn draws to its end, red flowers are scarce and the fragrance seldom spreads. The beauty of the landscape is so dear and so magnificent, no words can express it. We're near the end of our lecture. I'm going to show you one example of ongoing research at Edinburgh that has involved collaboration primarily through Paul Taylor there, colleagues at Oxford, Plymouth, Manchester University, so it'd be Alison Raby and Peter Stansby and others, and also as far as Auckland University. It shows experiments carried out in the around 2001, where we focus waves together to form a multi-directional focused wave group coming together and then impacting with the shore as a means of expeditiously producing an extreme event. And recently, I've taken my most recent student who's about to complete, Frances Judge, models the same thing in her numerical model using the paddle signals that were supplied to her by Alison Raby, who helped conduct the original experiments in 2001. So very nice conclusion almost. So what about the future? Well, I anticipate that an institute or a centre of water research will eventually be established at Edinburgh, perhaps, hopefully, supported by a doctoral training centre covering pollution and water purification. I personally intend to continue my research activities concerning large rivers with Professor Jin Ren Ni at Peking University, lakes with Jan Oshosha, Peter Davis and others, and coastal processes with Paul Taylor, if you'll put up with me for much longer, and many others. I'm on the road to retirement. My bus pass arrived today, a bit like, can you believe it? And I look forward to a new generation of talented environmental engineers who will far outshine the limited lights from Borthwick Rock. I'd like to draw some general conclusions. We saw earlier on that water and sediment science involves a large range of scales, from the molecule to the ocean. Across the scales, the movement of sediment by water sculpts mysteriously beautiful, sometimes fractal, sometimes periodic, morphodynamic or morphological shapes. Human interference with natural fluvial systems is a mixed blessing. We must find a way of living more harmoniously with water and sediment. I have nurtured two long and very clear collaborations, very dear collaborations. One has been with Janos Josha, who is now rector of Budapest Műegyetem. I first got to know Janos almost 30 years ago and have benefited hugely from his and his colleagues' great knowledge of lakes, river, sediment, and all things chaotic. My other major collaboration is with Jin Ren Ni of Peking University, which began in the 1990s. We have worked together on many problems in environmental engineering, including all material fluxes in large rivers and water and wastewater treatment. I have been blessed with a wonderful collection of research students, colleagues and friends over the years, and this gallery contains images of several of my long-standing colleagues, including Rodney Tock Taylor and Paul Taylor, some of my academic friends, not all, I ran out of space, and a subset of old and previous generations of researchers, Floreat Hydrodynamica. Many thanks are due to Leslie Yellowlees, Hugh McCann, and Kahuro Brody for hosting the lecture, and especially to Louise Farkson, who has done so much to ensure that all the arrangements went smoothly. I'm indebted to her. And my other local colleagues are much appreciated too. My life would not be complete without the five wonderful people shown here. Gerard, his girlfriend Hannah, James, Jamie, and Heather. And my beautiful Jill is the deep still water to the shallow turbulence of the Borthwick. In the words of one of Edinburgh's most famous but failed engineering students, trusty, dusky, vivid, true, with eyes of gold and bramble dew, steel true and blade straight, the great artificer made my mate. Honour, anger, valour, fire, a love that life could never tire, death quench or evil stir, the mighty master gave to her. Teacher, tender, comrade, wife, a fellow farer, true through life, heart whole and soul free, the august father gave to me. We've reached the end of this inaugural lecture. This pair of photographs provided me by Hubert Chanson of Queensland University shows the elegance of a pair of water cascades. St. Edmund wishes St. Patrick well on this day, the 17th of March. Floreat aqua. Thank you. I welcome any questions.